The primary thought that I'm trying to communicate to you is that there's a life in Christ that functions a specific way because God is a perfect Father and He fathers us perfectly and we are His sons and He cares about our development. I mean, you can understand that a perfect Father would care about the development of His son. He wants the son to progress from one thing to another. We're instantaneously become His son. He implants a dynamite, a power into our lives. It radically and fundamentally changes us. We become a new creature in Christ Jesus. Our last name changes, our passport changes, our identity changes, our purpose changes. Everything changes at that moment in time, but there's a lot of things that don't change. Our flesh doesn't change. Our understanding doesn't change. Our intellect doesn't change. Our thought process don't change. And He wants those things to change as well. He wants to minister change into our lives and grow us up in a process. And I don't know why He did it this way. I mean, why, you know, He could have just said, when you receive salvation, you got 24 hours to get your affairs in order, and then you're coming to heaven to live with me forever, you know? Or He could have said, you know, like a lot of TV preachers would like you to believe, you get saved and everything will be hunky-dory on earth. You know, God's kingdom has come on earth, and you are, you know, experiencing kingdom now. You know, well, what a wonderful thing, kingdom now. Let me tell you what kingdom now really is. Kingdom warfare is what you're in. You're in a struggle between darkness and light. You're in a struggle between the anointing of God and the demonic power forces that flow in this earth, the reigning and ruling spirits that we wrestle not with flesh and blood, but we wrestle with principalities and powers and rulers of darkness. Does that sound easy? Doesn't sound easy to me. It doesn't. You know, there's nothing easy about this, you know. I'm not selling you a bill of goods. This is not some glorified biblical Amway session we're having here where I'm the guy at the top and I make most of my money selling you tapes.
There are more than 100,000 direct salespeople in Russia and over 600,000 in China.
In fact, one of the things that set me free to do this program is that I don't really care about the results. I mean, God gave me a vision of doing this program. He gave me an understanding of what I'm supposed to do, and I'm just here doing it out of obedience. So whether there's a huge amount of results or a little results, God is sovereign. He's in control of who sees this. He's in control of who buys into it, who really gains understanding from it. And so I'm free of all that. I don't want to be on the cover of Charisma magazine. I don't give a rip about things like that. I don't care. You know, I've sold 1.3 million copies of books. Very few people in the history of the world can say that. You understand? I've had two books, number two on the Christian bestsellers list. I've never been number one, but us at number two, we try harder. I don't care. I don't care. I'm totally set free. I'm walking free from all that stuff. I'm here to share with you what changed my life and what has helped me, and to share it with you in a way that hopefully it'll help you, and then you can internalize it and help others. That's what this is all about, really. So an understanding that we're at war, this is a process, it's a twofold process. There's something that happens instantaneous, and then there's a life that happens before God. And God gets the glory out of you walking out that journey. And as your father, He wants you to grow up from a kid in diapers to being a mature warrior for Him in His kingdom. Someone who's capable of representing Him on the earth and being His hand extended. And so in understanding that, we understand that the blessing is the first phase. Blessing is that God knows us. He unconditionally accepts us. He unconditionally loves us. And he meets our needs according to what? Our behavior? According to our faith? According to our actions? No. He meets our needs according to his riches and glory. And it's okay to be needy. God wouldn't meet our needs if we didn't have any needs, or if it wasn't okay to have needs. So that's what God does for us before we ever do anything for him, before we ever exercise anything but faith to receive the gift of salvation and adoption. And in fact, he gives us the ability to have that faith to receive the gift of salvation and adoption. So he gets all the credit in this thing, folks. Really, he gets 100% of the credit. You were not a seeker. You were not seeker sensitive. You had no sensitivity to God at all unless he created the sensitivity. You were not seeking after God. He was drawing you by his Spirit. He was preveniently operating in your life before you even recognized him. He was taking thousands of steps towards you before you ever took a step toward him. And when you took that step toward him, it was in response to a call from his heart, speaking into your ear, "Come, be my son." And you slightly turned your head in his direction, and he empowers you to turn the rest of the way and to move in a different direction, which is the what we know as repentance. You left the direction you were going, you're moving in a different direction, and then he enters into a place where you have full remission of all your sins. So everything done up until the point of becoming a son is gone. It disappeared. It's of no influence in eternity. And then everything you do forward is covered by the blood of his son, Jesus Christ, and he can only see it through Jesus. So you have imputed righteousness in operational in your life. You have grace. You've received something you didn't deserve, and you have mercy. He's prevented you from receiving things you did deserve going in your life. And it's called the gospel of grace and peace for a reason. The gospel of grace and the cessation of againstness. God is no longer against you. He is for you. Why is he for you? Because he's your father. And he's your father. He's a perfect father who fathers perfectly. And so he's going to do all these things in your life before you ever do anything for him. And then you're going to go into his discipleship program or discipline program, where he uses circumstances of life and other things and mentors and the church to grow you into a mature individual who will represent his kingdom on the earth. That's what it looks like. But when we get over here, when we get to the place where we're receiving training, our will is being dealt with, where we're being taught, we're gaining wisdom in our mind, our minds are being renewed to the Word of God, we're thinking different thoughts, we're behaving differently, not because we have to, but because we want to. We're wanting to please the Father, we're wanting to honor Him, we're wanting to glorify Him as a response to the grace we've received. We're motivated to move the right direction. He's going to correct us when we go the wrong direction. But look, in that correction, where he uses his rod and staff against us to bring us back on the path, in the midst of that, he said, "A bruised reed I will not break, and a smoking flax I will not extinguish." He's not going to throw you away. He's not going to. He's already worked your stupid into the plan. You understand? The mistakes you make, the errors you make, the intentional sins you're going to commit, and you will. He's already worked that into the plan. He's working your forgiveness. He's working your redemption. All of it's been worked out beforehand. He knew it would all exist. He knows. And then he rewards you for diligently seeking him. Now, guess what? None of this happens without faith. You have to step out in faith over and over and over again as you go through this process. It is a requirement that you hang your body on his word, that you trust him implicitly with your life. I think one of the most fruitless exercises with Almighty God is to ask Him why. The better response to a situation where you think, why did this happen, is to ask, Father, what's next? Where do I go from here? The why may or may not be explained in your lifetime. Asking doesn't get Him to respond. I assure you of that. But asking Him what's next, where's my next step of obedience going to take me from here, will bring healing to the wounds that were in your life that brought you to the question why. That's a whole nother topic. We'll cover it in depth some other day. So we want to exercise faith, but what is faith? What is faith? Well, I learned something early on in my Christianity and my walk. It's very simple. I did not make this up. Okay, folks, I didn't create this. So much of what I'm communicating to you was communicated to me in some way or another by different people. I read Floyd McClung's book, Father Heart of God, way back when. I read constantly. I pray constantly. I've been ministered to by God in specific ways. There are things that I've created from scratch, yes. There's a lot of things that I can take credit for. But there's a lot of things that I'm speaking to you that are known truths. You know, people have known them for thousands of years. They were revealed to the Apostle Paul. And all I'm doing is regurgitating and defining in modern day terms so you can understand. Okay, so I'm not taking credit for this. So ABCs of faith. It's a simple way to understand what faith really is. Faith is not going down to the racetrack and putting $2 on horse number 6 and having a hope that it will win. That's not faith. That's not biblical. In any way, shape, you don't treat God that way, and God doesn't respond that way. Okay, so what are we going to do on the ABCs of faith? Well, that's a good question, and I'll tell you what we're going to do on the ABCs of faith in just a moment.
God Loves Kids is urgently trying to meet the needs of children in Uganda. They need your help.
Uganda as a country is running out of food, both at school, Phillips Career School International, and at GLK homes where our kids are staying. And God Loves Kids is the main source of food supply so far towards the GLK homes and the school. You can make a donation today to save a life, to feed kids who cannot help themselves, who cannot move out of the houses and cannot support themselves. God bless you as you give a donation to God Loves Kids to save a life.
Donate to God Loves Kids. Text God Loves Kids to 77977 or hit the donate button at godloveskids.org.
So here's where we're at. We're at the ABCs of faith. I'm giving you a handle. Okay, I talked to you about the last show about finding a good instructor who would give you life hacks. ABCs of faith is a life hack. It's something that I've used in my own life over and over and over again to understand what my role as a son is and what I'm actually doing in response to God. So A is action. B is belief. C is confidence. Okay? Action, belief, confidence equal faith. Okay, so the word faith is pistis. You have pistis and you have apistis. Pistis is faith moving forward. Apistis is faith moving backwards. You are never in neutral. Nobody exists in neutral. You either are believing in God and you're faithing His direction, or you are resisting God and you're believing the other direction and you're stepping out on based on beliefs that take and empowerment that take you the other way. There's no in between. You're either going forward or you're going backwards. No neutral, no park. So when you get out of a bed in the morning and you swing your legs out of bed and you place your feet on the ground, you are acting upon the belief that there's a thing called gravity. And you're not going to float up to the roof. It's that simple. You know, every time you do an action that is toward the things of God. Giving is a wonderful example because giving is the biggest test, consistent test of faith we have.
You for the check.
Oh, no!
Bless you, child. Bless you.
Look, give it to her.
Yes.
When I receive something that God has given me, am I going to recognize His existence and worship Him by giving Him a portion that He says is His? I'm going to take a portion of everything I receive and I'm going to give it to God because He's already said that that's mine. Don't rob me of it, you know? And then I'm going to give some offerings besides. I am a giver, not a taker, okay? And I believe as I'm doing this, I believe that I can live better off of this than I can the whole because I'm trusting God to do that. You see that? You notice I didn't say anything about harvest. Doesn't matter. One of the greatest functions of giving is that you're acting in faith. And every time you act in faith, you increase your connection to God. Your relationship to God grows closer. And so giving is an ability to respond to God. Man, I deposit my check at the ATM. I pull over, I hit push pay, and I give to my church consistently. And I give to God Loves Kids throughout the year. And I have an amount that I want to give to God Loves Kids. And I have an amount that I need to give to my church. And I do that immediately. First thing after depositing my check. Why? I'm the ADD boy. I don't want to wait till Sunday. I want the first thing I do to be my giving so I don't spend it somewhere else. And I don't want to have to put it in my savings account and then take it back out to give. So you understand that A is an action. I am going to do something. You say, well, that sounds like works. No, works are only works as we know it in the Bible. When you say works-based religion, works are Jesus and. So if you say, in order to be saved and maintain your salvation, you have to have faith in Jesus and do X, Y, Z. That becomes works, a works-based religion. The fact that you have to do something in your relationship with God, in order to achieve specific results that God wants you to achieve in your life is not works. You're not doing that to maintain your sonship. You're doing that to benefit you and the kingdom of God on the earth. Do you see the difference? So action, I'm acting. Why am I acting? Because God has given me something, a command either from Scripture, a command either directly to myself, and I'm responding to that command with action based on that I have a command. I'm not acting without a command because acting without a command is not faith. So I'm acting based on the command, and that whole process is sustained by confidence of the reality of God, that God is more real than anything in existence. And you say, well, that's where I get lost because I'm not quite sure.
Whoa.
Look, if you haven't had a dramatic, intimate, personal, powerful encounter with God, you need to.
Whoa.
And it's quite simple. Get on your knees every morning and ask God, God, I need a personal, dramatic, intimate, powerful encounter with you. Now, you notice I didn't tell you what that would look like or how that would happen or that you needed that dramatic, powerful encounter with God to be saved. But I can't imagine being saved without it. Why? Because the Father wants to show himself real to his children. He wants to make himself manifest in your life. The Bible says, my sheep know my voice. Let's put it another way. My sons know what their father's voice sounds like. You would expect a perfect father to be able to perfectly communicate with his children. So God has the ability of breaking through the natural in your life and dragging you into the supernatural dimension of who he is and making sure that you've experienced him in such a way that you do not doubt. And you say, well, you think God would answer that prayer for me? I know he will. Why? Because he wants to do it. But see, God makes promises in his word. God makes promises in his nature that he holds back, and he's waiting for you to pray, to ask him. That's part of the action. Dear Heavenly Father, make yourself real to me. You know, I prayed that over my children almost every night of their lives. God, make yourself real to my children. Why? Because I knew if he were real to them, they would never want to leave a relationship with him. Now, they might want to leave a relationship with me, or they might not want to live in my house. In fact, they weren't created to live in my house forever, thank God. I don't have a 28-year-old living in my basement. You know, and I thank the Lord for that. They weren't created to live with me for a lifetime. You know, they weren't created to obey me for a lifetime. Once a child reaches adulthood, they no longer have to obey their parents. Now, honor is a lifetime obligation. I honor my mother because she's my mother. I do. I think of ways to honor her. But if she says, Phil, you have to do this and you have to obey me.
Gee, Mom, do I have to?
I'd say, no, I don't. Why? Because I'm a full-grown man. And God has very much the ability to speak to me what he wants me to do and not do. Phil, you need to do this. Phil, you don't need to do this. As a parent, you don't need to be saying that to your grown children. As a parent, you need to focus only on blessing your children. Do I know them? Do I unconditionally accept them? Do I unconditionally love them? Am I meeting some of their needs? But you're no longer teaching, training, correcting, or rewarding those children. That's the Holy Spirit's job at this point. When they're little, you represent God in their life. So yes, when they're little, you are training. When they're little, you are teaching. When they're little, you are correcting. When they're little, you're rewarding. But when they grow to maturity and they become adult, you're no longer doing that. And that's the Holy Spirit's job. You, on the other hand, can represent the purity of God's grace in their life by knowing them, unconditionally accepting them, unconditionally loving them, and meeting their needs, and keeping your opinion to yourself unless they ask for it. Simple. That's how you maintain relationship with a grown child. If you really want to have a dramatic, intimate relationship with a child who's grown, that's how you do it. So I've got this intimacy with God. He shows me what he wants me to do. And I believe him. And I do it because I have the confidence of his reality. So ABCs of faith. It's an action based upon a belief sustained by confidence that God is real. He is more real than anything else that exists. He pre-existed all creation, and He exceeds all creation, and He wants to show off as your Father. So if you really want something dramatic to happen in your life, find out what God already wants to do and pray for that. Find out what God has already promised He would do and pray that He would do that. Find out what God's agenda is in your life and align yourself with God's agenda instead of fighting against it. Become instantaneously obedient. You know what my desire is? My desire is that God doesn't even have to speak to me for me to obey Him. That He can simply give me the eye and I know what He's thinking. You know, my daddy didn't have to speak. All he had to do is look from that pulpit and he would do this beside his leg. He would snap his fingers silently and he would turn that finger just right down by the side of his leg. He had my eye and I could see it, and he would do like that. And I knew I was in trouble, that whatever I was doing, I better stop doing, and I better look like an angel from that point on for the rest of the night. Or when we got home, there would be a transaction that took place between father and son. He didn't have to say a word. I knew exactly what he meant. And I want to have that kind of response to God. God, if you look to the left, I'll move to the left. If you look to the right, I'll move to the right. No argument, no resistance. No, it doesn't make sense. No, it's not logical. Just give me the word, God, and I will go. I'll do whatever you say you want me to do, anytime you want me to do it, any way you want me to do it, and I'll step out in faith instantly because I believe in you, and I haven't mentally ascended to an idea. That's not belief. You don't believe the plane will fly unless you're willing to get in the plane and allow it to take off. That's biblical faith. And so we want to lean on God as our staff of life, to the point that our weight is so far on Him that either He shatters because He's not real, or He sustains us. Did you understand that? The picture of faith in the Old Testament is a man who will lean on a staff, testing it, putting all his weight on it, and either the staff sustains his weight or it shatters. And the splinters go into his hand and he falls on the ground. Only two choices in life. Do you trust God to sustain you in all things? And will you step out in faith when you hear the voice of the caller?